A lot can be said about the 1992 classic, released at a time when one of the most epic console wars in history was just starting to heat up. Super Mario Kart wowed gamers and critics alike with its use of pseudo-3D graphics through use of Mode 7 and fast, fun gameplay. It showed a lot of people just what the SNES was capable of in terms of racers and brought the casual and hardcore alike to the living room to throw down on some split screen. Let's take a trip down memory lane and find out why this title was such a game changer. What's up guys, my name is Jonathan and this is Keep It Retro. There's just something about the charm of this game that can draw in anyone who happens to be watching at a distance. At its core, Super Mario Kart is a simple arcade racing game where the player races around different tracks, collecting power-ups, and avoiding obstacles. There's nothing too complicated to it, but it's indeed a formula that works, making an experience that can provide hours of fun and tons of replay value. Being that it is the first in the series, it will seem a little bare to the seasoned Mario Kart player, but it's still impressive to look back at a piece of software that launched a series that's still just as beloved today as it was over 20 years ago. Let's take a deeper look into this game with our review and decide if it's worth adding to your collection or not. At first, I wasn't expecting much from this title, considering its age and dated look, but to my surprise, I was treated with quite a bit packed into a little cartridge. Super Mario Kart features multiple modes catering to both single player and multiplayer options, as well as time trial and competitive battle mode. Aside from that, there are 8 playable characters to choose from and 3 different cups featuring new spins on prior courses and new ones to boot to help you keep the game fresh as you progress. The cups you have to choose from are called the Mushroom, Flower, and Star Cup. Each one gets more challenging than the last, forcing you to stay on your toes and use skill as you try to overtake other racers and steal first place. There is not a difficulty per se, but there are classes that can be chosen to help amp up the difficulty for those looking for more out of this game. 50 and 100cc class are likely the easy and normal setting, while 150cc is the game at hard. But as you can expect, this is a Mario game and as such should be pretty much accessible to all ages, and it can still surprise you and catch you off guard though. Two of the most quirky features I would like to make note of is the use of lives and the constant presence of split screen even if you are playing single player. The live system is unique and adds quite a challenge to the gameplay, and I think arcade fans especially can appreciate that. Fall too many times off the track or have any other mishaps and you could very well have a game over. I'm not familiar with this as I'm not the biggest fan of racers, but if I do happen to come across it again in the future, I'll be sure to mention it in other reviews. Now, on to the biggest gripe I have with the game, being the split screen. To me, it's one thing to have it when you're playing with a friend, but it's another to have it when you're playing by yourself. What would be a colorful sprite and track is now replaced by a map and some stats that will update you in real time. It is neat and it can be helpful, but with that being said, it can also be an eyesore, and for anyone coming over from modern games, it's kind of jarring to get used to only seeing a portion of your screen at one time. Also, the real-time updates are hard to read while racing since action can feel too hectic. The frame rate lacks that silky smooth feeling of 60 frames per second that allow you to quickly glance at things without risking a wreck. Other than that, it's my only real complaint, and by no means is it a deal breaker. If you can adjust to this, you can still have tons of fun. In a way, this game reminds me of Super Smash Bros., if nothing else but for its selection of great Nintendo characters and experimental vibe. It's also interesting to note that a few characters in this game were only playable in this title. Koopa Troopa and Donkey Kong Jr. were both replaced in the release of Mario Kart 64. But other than that slight change, the base characters have remained the same with the series staples such as Mario, Peach, and Bowser. I know that only having 8 characters to choose from might seem a little slim, but I think it's the perfect number to give you variety. Some characters even have special abilities in the forms of power-ups. Yoshi can collect eggs to throw out onto the track to try and catch unsuspecting players off guard, and while you think you may have left Bowser in the dust, he can still throw you a fireball that can burn your chances at winning. It's cool to see, but it's still sorely lacking when only a few characters have these. As for the vehicles in this game, there's not much variety there either, but I do give props to Nintendo for trying. The kart designs are simple and believable, which is nice considering how over the top some of the karts are in newer versions. Not saying it's a bad thing, but it's just cool to see some semblance of realism in a game that draws all of its appeal from fantasy. To help differentiate, they simply rendered the karts in different colors for certain characters. It's very primitive, but it's a nice touch. Other than that, you won't find too much more to help flesh out the experience. Although visuals are indeed dated, time has been somewhat kind to Super Mario Kart. It's no secret that early 3D games could be kind of fugly. And the SNES was no exception. Both the Genesis and SNES came around at a time when software was starting to give developers the ability to make 3D environments and gaming a reality. But just like with anything new, the end result was usually rough around the edges. In my opinion, 2D games on that console will always stay as beautiful as the day they were rendered. But nonetheless, for the time, it was an impressive thing, and I have to give it credit for delivering on that experience. Even though this game is not true 3D, it does have plenty of tricks to make the illusion of it work smoothly. I was impressed by how the sprites and other decor littering the stage came to life and still impresses me with how thoughtful some of it is. Even with the limitations of the console, it was used to great effect to create a game, though maybe not as grown up as Virtual Racer on the Genesis, it is still aged better and would be something that could catch the eye of even children born in the smartphone age. And that does say a lot. Regardless of where you stand on graphics, you can expect the standard Nintendo fare of bright, colorful worlds and characters with quirky and memorable designs. Bluntly put, just a few seconds of viewing the gameplay is enough to let you know who made it. But I wouldn't be doing a racing game justice if I didn't mention the tracks you race on. The overall design is very fun as you zip around multiple locations from the Mushroom Kingdom. I love how you never know what to expect, and just as you round the corner, you could be facing a hidden path or a patch of jumps sending you soaring over other racers as they try to catch up. You can't really rely on patterns because of the changes that happen each time you change the cup you're racing on, so it's on you to be aware of where you're going at all times. I've had more than a few instances where I've driven straight off the track due to no fault but my own. Just like with any arcade racing game, the aim is to make it something anyone can pick up and play. The controls are simple and responsive, and really need no explanation beyond playing around with a few button presses. That is something that makes not only this game, but retro games in general, so appealing. It takes us back to a time when gameplay was cut and dry. You didn't have multiple button combinations to confuse the hell out of you, no. Just turn on and tune out. The only real skills I needed to master learning was to use my brakes around the corners and to steady my aim when trying to hit a character with shells. But for the most part, all I had to do was approach this as I would on the 64 or even the Wii version. It's basically no different. But as anyone who has played these before knows, it will always be fun and easy to get into, which makes this an excellent party game to play with your friends or to play with your family and introduce young children to retro games. Even though this isn't the most impressive game in the SNES library, it still earned its place amongst gaming's greats thanks to its innovation, graphics, and fun gameplay. Thanks to this breakthrough title, Super Mario Kart has enjoyed a long and successful history that will continue well into the future. So, by all means, add this to your collection of SNES games, and it will provide you fun and entertainment for many, many more years to come. If you happen to catch this one out in the wild, be sure to grab a copy because it's well worth the money. Thank you for taking the time to watch my video today. Don't forget to subscribe and check back often because I do upload videos weekly. So, for the latest in retro and modern video game news and reviews, one of your game today. Thank you.
second.